free tattoos lead to the suspension of 5 Buckeyes.
The news now made official, Rich Rodriguez fired as head coach.
An NCAA violation occurred on my part.
When we run out on the practice field, we're going to compete. And we're going to compete every day. Because you get better when you compete. And that's what we're going to do.
Sometimes you just feel tired. Feel weak. You feel like you want to just give up. But you gotta search within you. Try to find that inner strength and just pull that shit out of you and get that motivation to not give up and not be a quitter. No matter how bad you want to just fall flat on your face.
So I collapse, I'm spilling these raps long as you feel them. To the day that I drop, you'll never say that I'm not killing them. Cause when I am not, then I'ma stop pinning them. And I am not hip hop, and I'm just not Eminem. Subliminal thoughts. When I'ma stop spinning them, women are caught in webs, spin them in hawk venom, adrenaline shot. The penicillin could not get the illin to stop. Amoxicillin's just not real enough. The criminal cop killing hip hop, filling a minimal swap to cop millions of pop listeners. You're coming with me, feel it or not. You're gonna fear it like I showed you. The spirit of God lives in us. You hear it a lot, lyrics the shock. Is it a miracle or am I just product of pop? This enough. The sizzle, my whistle, this is the plot. Listen up. God's little does not give up.
Till the roof comes off, till the lights go out, till my leg give out, can't shut my mouth. Till the smoke clears out, and my heart burn out. I'ma rip this shit till my bone pull out. Till the roof comes off, till the lights go out, till my leg give out, can't shut my mouth. Till the smoke clears out, and my heart burn out. I'ma rip this shit till my bone pull out.
Now 13ABC Action Sports presents the Northwest Ohio Ford Dealers Border Battle Kickoff Show, getting you ready for the Ohio State Buckeyes and the Michigan Wolverines. Now, live from the Big House in Ann Arbor, here's 13ABC Sports Director Dave Holmes.
Welcome to Michigan Stadium for the 108th playing of the game, Ohio State against Michigan, or if you'd rather, Michigan against Ohio State. Good morning, everyone. I'm Dave Holmes. Thank you so much for joining us here on the Northwest Ohio Ford Dealers Border Battle Kickoff Show.
So it's on to Game 7, which just happens to be another must win.
Can you believe it? Game 7. A week ago, many fans didn't think they'd see Game 5, but here they are, the Red Wings, a chance to become the fourth team in NHL history to come back from 0-3 to win a series.
Joe, weather reports here in D.C. say that Wednesday's Military Bowl could see wind gusts in the neighborhood of about 40 miles an hour. Dave, not only did that morning shower cause the rain delay, but it also softened up the greens, kind of taking the teeth out of Inverness.
Joe, if there wasn't enough wind in Chicago already, they're adding more, just blowing trash off the field, and that's one way to describe how the Lions played Sunday afternoon.
So tomorrow it'll be Bowling Green against Eastern Michigan. The winner goes to the NCAA tournament. The Falcons will be the heavy favorite, but as Toledo, that means nothing in this tournament. At the Quicken Loans Arena, Dave Holmes, 13ABC Action Sports.
In the Irish Hills, I'm Joe Nugent.
Reporting from Cleveland Browns Stadium, Steve Slifka.
In Detroit,
at the Horseshoe.
Michigan Stadium.
13ABC Action Sports.
Finally, I'm off tomorrow night. I won't get to see you on Christmas Eve, so now is my chance to wish you a Merry Christmas and give you the gift of poem one day early. Here's a look back at an amazing year in sports. 'Twas the night before Christmas, and all through the town, there were sports fans remembering how this year went down. After 7 long years, no more Michigan choke, their hopes now restored by their own Brady Hoke. While down in Columbus, a rough year is through with a temporary coach and some permanent tattoos, but now there is hope with a new coaching hire. For Christmas this year, here's a gift, Urban Meyer. But not every coach had so happy a fate, like Paterno, Sandusky, and those at Penn State. While here in Toledo, a year to enjoy till a coach packed his bags and left for Illinois. But still, all the Rockets accomplished their goal. For the second straight year, they're off to a bowl. While down at BG, there's a new place to go. For hoops, let it strow, let it strow, let it strow. In high school, St. Ursula sure put up a fight. In soccer and volleyball, it was close but not quite. For Perrysburg baseball, a similar fate. The Jackets came up just a game short of state. For Rogers and Start and Central, the same great seasons that ended with heartbreaking games, and the boys from Whitmer, a season so fun till 13-0 turned to 13-1. And back in the spotlight, the silver and blue, their attitude led by Ndamukong Suh. While the Cavs were so awful, their luck changed real quick from the worst in the league to the number one pick. Big Papa was perfect, nothing more, nothing less. His Tigers advanced to the ALCS, and the Rockets a new trophy to put on the shelf. The Trojans had nothing to fear but Shafir herself. The U.S. Senior Open, a magnificent scene. In the end, Olin Brown left his mark on the greens, and two selfish leagues in a full legal brawl made us question why we even love their sports at all. But the fact is we do, and sports is our heaven. Merry Christmas to all. What a great 2011. What a great year. I'm Dave Ho Ho Holmes wishing you and your family a Merry Christmas and Happy New Year. It's an interesting way of looking at it. Rivalry as cooperation. Two sides look at each other and say the only thing we have in common is a strong disliking. Rivals need each other. Light wouldn't exist without darkness. Rivals might hate each other, but they love to hate each other. They're competitive, proud, passionately illogical to think that another group of people is evil simply because they wear a different colored shirt. It's time to celebrate rivalries. Falcons against Rockets, Bowling Green against Toledo, that team down south against that team from the north. The I-75 rivalry is next.
Well, there's a new asphalt surface at Michigan International Speedway, only the fourth in track history, and for some strange reason, they let me take one of the first laps on it.
Here we are, taking the green flag on the front stretch, close to 150 miles per hour. Remember Dale Earnhardt, Carl Edwards, all those guys doing close to 200 right there. Going to dive into turn one right now, and wow, I can really feel the G's. It is taking some muscle just to hold on to the camera. In the repaving process, we actually found out that the track has progressive banking, which means it's steeper up top. Out of the backstretch, where Chip is putting the pedal all the way down. This is a moment to relax before turns three and four. Okay, now down into turn three. Just imagine getting off the freeway at 135 miles per hour. That's what this feels like. I'm absolutely slamming up against the right side of the seat. Turn four, and now back into the sun on the front stretch. I don't think I've ever been on a smoother road. Can't feel a thing. The Cup drivers are gonna love this place. Chip pushing hard for the stripe, and that was one lap around a freshly repaved Michigan International Speedway.
Sweet.
It's time for the world premiere of the 2011 Border Battle Rap. The real one right here, hope. They said we couldn't top last year, but we got to show them. The pinnacle of rivalry, follow me and hear the fans chant it. Seeds of hate planted and they've grown up like a Buckeye tree. Both sides agree, I hate you and you're not fond of me. That's our decree, let's put it on a marquee so that all can see the way we're feeling. Emotions that we all are dealing, deck our places out from the basement to the highest ceiling. Joy stealing when your team is the one that's reeling. Like a misbehaving dog, there's no way you can get a healing. Quit your squealing, Wolverines, and hit the Bucks so hard you'll make them scar with tattoos of your maize and blue helmet wings. Blood trickles from the beat, hoax and the fighting fickles. Physicality is fine with me, no place for tears and sniffles. Clear as crystal, fired up just like a launch missile. Game stuck on my brain like Thomas Jefferson is stuck on nickel. Makes sense? Like the OSU defense? They've been seeing dead QBs like Haley Joel in Sixth Sense. So intense, but Denard, man, he's hard to guard, and that's who they are seeking. Man, he's peeking like a picket fence.
Oh, Michigan beat the Bucks today.
It's a border war, and pride is what we're playing for. But this year feels so different from the many years we played before. I know it's sore, and the Bucks would like me to ignore their reputation in the nation's ever closer to the floor. There's only so much scandal a college team can handle, but I think on them just like the tattoos that the players traded for. A sinking vessel, so see you later, Dressel. Luke Fickle, get us out this pickle. Here's the keys to the horseshoe castle. Let's kill the beat a minute while I spit it and sample my wit. My rhyming skills so hot to handle, you might need an oven mitt. Bring the baseline back like a vertebrae. Shout out to the Scarlet and Gray, hunting Wolverines like they are the prey. But Michigan is looking at brighter days, they're back to the winning ways, knocking out opponents like Woody Hayes.
Oh, Michigan beat the Bucks today.
Show them what you're made of.
Take it to the scarlet and gray.
Wolverines.
Oh, yes, you show them why you're great.
Another loss Michigan can't afford. Tired of coming up short. You put the work in, now go get your reward. Time to bounce back like a bungee cord. Wolverine pride restored. Go put on a football clinic like Betty Ford. Ohio State, victory is your fate. Winners of 7 straight. Okay, technically last year's game you had to vacate. Time to move on from the tattoo gate. No players to reinstate. Make your legacy grow faster than inflation rates.
Oh, Michigan beat the Bucks today.
Show them what you're made of.
PGA Championship history happened right here at Inverness, but nobody saw it. It was 1993. Daryl Kessner, a club pro from New York, didn't draw much of a gallery, but his wife followed him that day with a video camera. She filmed the entire front nine, but then noticed her battery was starting to die. Daryl said, no problem, just conserve battery, don't film every shot. So Daryl came to the 13th hole, a par 5 here at Inverness, and he hit a beautiful drive. It left him 222 yards to the hole. Now Kessner could see the television crews packing up behind the green because it was late in the day, and let's face it, this was Daryl Kessner, not Greg Norman. Well, you can see it coming. Kessner hit a 5-wood, and it bounced right into the hole. Only about 8 people saw it because the camera wasn't rolling, which begs the question, if you make a double eagle and no one's around, does it really make a sound?
This 2011 U.S. Senior Open Insider was brought to you by 13ABC and the University of Toledo Medical Center, a higher degree of healing.
What a game at the Big House. The Wolverines do it. Their first win against the Buckeyes since 2003.
Not that Woody or Bo would have liked to see 70-some points, but these Michigan fans, they don't care. They get their first win with Brady Hoke.
Senior day at Michigan Stadium. Kevin Coger's last as a Wolverine captain, and the Buckeyes striking their opening possession. Ohio State going with a pass-first strategy early. Braxton Miller hits a wide-open Corey Philly Brown. That a 54-yard touchdown, 7-0 Bucks. On the next possession, Miller looking at a 3rd and long. Braxton trying to find some room, but instead he's run down from behind by Jordan Kovacs. A sack for the Clay Eagle, the first big play for the Maize and Blue. That leads to a 41-yard Denard Robinson touchdown. He had 170 yards on 26 carries, the first of 3 touchdowns in the game, rushing touchdowns, and we're tied at 7. After a safety, Michigan extends their 2-point lead to 9 with a 26-yard pass to Junior Hemingway, and that caps off a very high-scoring first quarter. In the second, Ohio State capitalizes on a Michigan turnover. Miller rolls 19 yards to the end zone, moves the Bucks back in front by 1, 17-16. He had 100 yards on 16 carries. Robinson right back at him. Yes, this was a showdown between 2 athletic quarterbacks. Michigan leads 23-17. With less than 2 minutes to go in the half, Braxton connects with Devere Posey for a Big House silencing 43-yard touchdown. Ohio State up 1 at the break. Early third quarter, Denard throws a touchdown to Martavius Odoms. Shoelace threw as many TDs as he had incompletions, 14 of 17 and 3 touchdowns. To the fourth, in an absolute shootout, the Wolverines go play action. The senior captain out of Whitmer High School, Kevin Coger, scores his first touchdown against the Bucks, and the Wolverines are in control, up 10 with 8:30 to go. But it is far from over. Ohio State goes right down the field. Boom Heron caps it off with a 4-yard run, Bucks down 3. Michigan adds a field goal for a 6-point lead. Ohio State's final drive in the final minute ends with the ball in Courtney Avery's hands. The Wolverines win it 40-34 as 114,000 celebrate an end of a drought that lasted almost 2,900 days. Brady Hoke joins Bo Schimbecker, Gary Moore, and Lloyd Carr as Michigan coaches to win their first against the Buckeyes.
And you have to wonder on the other side, what does the future hold for Luke Fickell? But nonetheless, a huge win today for Michigan.
What satisfies you when you see those kids in that locker room and you saw them on the field, how happy. Because they, it's been a struggle. It wasn't easy. And it's fun for as a coach to see them and how they responded and how hard they worked.
Going through what we've gone through, this is my third coach, third offensive coordinator, third O-line coach, third strength coach. It's been a lot, and it's been a roller coaster that, as for some reason, seemed like it would never get good. But, you know, we kept fighting. It's just like the old saying goes, those who stay will be champions. We all stayed together. We all were one as a senior class. In the end, you truly realize what this place means the power that that Block M has on your chest. You know, I love Michigan. There's no doubt about it. I don't care what we had to go through. I love this school. I love this university. I love this team. I love my teammates. I love my coaches. You know, this is great. This is what college football is.
I've always said, I mean, my dream has always been to catch a touchdown in the Ohio State-Michigan game, and I finally did that, so it means a lot to me and my family. But first and foremost, I wanted to just find a teammate to celebrate with, and I found a lot of those guys running around there crazy like the chicken with head cut off. But just like the Martell Webbs of the world and John Farrar's of the world that didn't get a chance to beat Ohio State, I mean, hopefully they can live through us, because we definitely did for them.
The respect for the Ohio State-Michigan rivalry, I wasn't going to think about it, I wasn't going to talk about it.
Were you informed, though, at all this week what your status is or what the situation is with the coaching situation?
Like I said, it's about the Ohio State-Michigan. It's been about that since Sunday, and it's going to be about that always.
If I was on the Board of Trustees, I would give you that answer. But I don't know, man. I love Coach Fickell, man. He's a great guy. He's a great coach. And he's a great leader. I can't make that call. And all I know is I love playing for the man.
You know, we did have him on our wristbands, and we did have Coach Fickell on our wristbands, and we did have Coach Daniels down our wristbands. And, you know, that was what a lot of guys were playing for.
So a huge win for Michigan, for those seniors, their legacy intact. They graduate with a win over the Scarlet and Gray.
And if you're Ohio State, you go back 8 years and you say you get 7 out of 8, I think you'll take it. But today, it's all about Michigan and a 6-point win here at the Big House.
Opening day, another fun one at Fifth Third Field, and the fun actually started much earlier than expected. Yes, the game started at 4 o'clock, but I went undercover to give you a behind-the-scenes look at everything that happened on opening day. 10:36 a.m., the Swamp Shop already open for business, shelves are being stocked. 10:52 a.m., employees sweeping the aisles, probably wondering how they're even dirty since this is the first game of the season. 11:03 a.m., cups are being stacked, condiments are prepared, everyone works much harder once they're filmed. 11:12 a.m., the beer gets put on ice, hours later it will be sold for 7 times its actual value. 11:17, popcorn starts popping, boxes being filled. 11:22, I tried to get free food by mentioning Lee Conklin's name. The cashier looks at me and says, who? 11:27, the first Mud Hens arrive at the ballpark. 11:43, the infield is hosed down, and I start to wonder, if you soak it willingly, why are you so quick to cover it when it rains? 11:49, it's sprinkling outside, some of the Hens start taking indoor batting practice. 12:11, General Manager Joe Napoli gets a phone call, contents unknown, but it must be a secret. He escapes into the shadows. 12:52, the players take the field to stretch. They assure me that no one will actually run like this during the game. 1:01, the infield is raked just in time for the players to start taking outdoor batting practice. 1:22 p.m., the doors aren't open to the public for 8 more minutes, but one fan must have beaten security. No one seems worried. 1:30, doors open for Mud Hens happy hour. 2:09, Hens finish batting practice and start answering tough questions from the media, like, are you excited for opening day?
I feel like the fans are excited about it. We were home yesterday off and kind of creating a little bit of a buzz around town, and it's fun, it's exciting.
2:15 p.m., Columbus Clippers take batting practice. 3:10, food is served in the media room. I'm going dark for the next 20 minutes. 3:37, the ceremonial first pitch by the 180th Fighter Wing. 3:40, player introductions. 3:52, national anthem by Miss Ohio Becky Minger. Creepy man in the bleachers asks, it is Miss Ohio, right? 3:55, flyover ignites the crowd, and finally we are ready to play ball. This is going to take some brass, and I might be risking a pink slip, but here goes nothing. You're getting very sleepy. You will give in to my demands. First things first, I want a raise. Not much, like maybe 1G. I want a comfy couch in my office to rest my back. It's a little sore from carrying this newscast every night. I want a clause in my contract that says I get free lunch every day. Tomorrow, make it a hero sandwich. I'm sick of being treated like I'm the B team. I want to be on top of the respect pyramid. Move over, Lee and Diane. More vacation days. I want the entire month of March off. Oh, and a gym membership. My own personal hairstylist. A statue of me in front of the building made of copper. And believe me, I'll picket to get what I want. Until you meet my demands, I refuse to work. Try me. I'm stubborn as a mule.
Good
Good news, bad news for the Tribe. Grady Sizemore headed back to the DL for the third time this year. It's a bruised knee, and he'll be out at least 15 days. The good news, the Indians open up a doubleheader against Minnesota in a big way this afternoon. A four-run third inning gets it done. First, Ezekiel Carrera drives in Lonnie Chisenhall. Then two on for Asdrubal Cabrera, who unloads. A three-run bomb to right, Indians a winner, 5-2. That means the Idle Tigers now fall a half game behind the Tribe. Detroit only took one of three this past weekend at home against the White Sox. And it makes you wonder if there is some minor concern about the team's second-half reputation. Under Jim Leland, the club has not been good after the break, still looking for that first second half above 500. And on the flip side, the Hens absolutely on fire here in the month of July. Just like the steaming hot temps, the Hens are stepping it up. They're 10-4 following last night's walk-off win. And it begs the question, what makes July different than June?
Both have four. I'm trying to figure out. They both have four letters, June, July. I don't know. Honestly, I don't know. We're just playing better. I mean, it just happened to be the turn of the calendar.
July, I mean, yeah, we look a lot better right now, and I think we're playing a little better. And, yeah, all around, we just look a lot better than we were at the beginning of the year, even though I still think we had a good team all along. Just things are clicking right now.
College football right around the corner. Camps open up in a few weeks, and a lot of eyes on the Rockets this year. It could be the best team in the MAC. We'll see. In addition, Adonis Thomas is on the Doak Walker Award watch list. That goes to the top running back in the country. He pretty much should have the MAC wrapped up with an average of more than 6 yards per carry last year. Eric Page is among 40 that could win the Walter Camp Player of the Year Award. Coaches and athletic administrators vote on this one, kind of like the Heisman Trophy.